Hello, my name is Albert, and I'm a maths PhD student at UCL studying geometric analysis.
And my name is David. I too am a maths PhD student at UCL, and I study geometric group theory. Together, we're going to be running the last LMO course this term on the subject of symmetries. Albert will be in the third video today, so for now, goodbye, Albert. In this course, we're going to begin somewhere which is hopefully very familiar to you. Geometry in the plane, and symmetries of shapes, rotations, reflections, and so on. This week, we will try and understand precisely what symmetries are in a mathematical sense, and re-examine familiar ideas in a new context, namely using something called group theory, a topic which is central to almost all contemporary mathematics. Next week, we will take this further and focus on the symmetries of infinite patterns, tessellations in other words. Using groups, we will be able to discover all possible tessellations of the plane using group theory and study their properties. In the final class, we shall escape the plane and see what happens when we try to make shapes and patterns on curved surfaces. In particular, this means the surface of a sphere and, if time permits, the hyperbolic plane. This is a surface which is something like a negative sphere, and I think I can say without exaggeration that it is one of the coolest things ever discovered by humans. I want to start off by thinking about what symmetries are. You can look at a shape or pattern and pretty easily see whether or not it has symmetry. A square, for example, clearly has symmetry. You can rotate and reflect it. My face, too, has bilateral symmetry. Something like this, on the other hand, clearly is not symmetric. What about this shape? Would you say that it is symmetrical? You can kind of make arguments either way. The design has rotational symmetry, but the colours don't exactly match up. What about the wallpaper pattern behind me? Would you say that this has symmetry? That's perhaps tricky. When I've asked students that sort of question in the past, it has divided opinion. Maths doesn't deal well with ambiguity or opinion. Instead, mathematicians like to work with clear definitions. We therefore need to agree on a definition of what a symmetry is. Let's think about the example of a square. We said that a square is symmetric because we can rotate and reflect it. Therefore, a working definition of symmetry might be a transformation which leaves the object looking the same. So a reflection is a transformation of the square, and after reflecting the square, we can't see a difference. This is still not good enough for mathematicians, because we haven't clarified what we mean by transformation and looking the same. For example, if we enlarge the square by a factor of 2, this is a transformation, and the result still looks like a square, just bigger. But we don't want to call this a symmetry of the square. If we did, then every shape would be symmetric, because we could just enlarge it, and that would count as a symmetry. There is no right way to specify what is meant by a transformation or by looking the same. As a mathematician, you are free to choose whatever you like. The result will be a different notion of symmetry and a different set of objects which are symmetric. You have to make the choice which is most useful for the problem that you're trying to solve. For example, you could say that the types of transformations which are allowed are homeomorphisms, which Todd and Angela talked about in their course. Homeomorphisms encompass a very large class of transformations, so lots of shapes are homeomorphic to one another. And this is useful when you're interested in topological questions. In this course, we are going to focus on the most common choice of definition of a symmetry, which uses the Euclidean metric. This is just the maths name for the normal way that you measure distance in the two-dimensional plane. It's named after Euclid, an ancient Greek mathematician who lived around 300 BCE. He wrote a book called The Elements, in which he set out, among other things, the theory of the geometry of the plane starting from first principles. I'll just quickly remind you how we calculate the distance between points with the Euclidean metric. Suppose two points, A and B, have Cartesian coordinates, x1, y1 and x2, y2 respectively. Then we can form a right triangle and use Pythagoras' theorem to find the distance. We can use this metric to make precise what we mean by transformation. An isometry is a special transformation of the Euclidean plane which preserves the Euclidean metric. The name is, perhaps unsurprisingly, derived from Greek. Iso means same and metry means measure. So an isometry is something which gives the same measure. In particular, the same measure of distance between points. Let's unpack the definition a bit more. A transformation of the plane is a rule that sends each point in the plane to another point in the plane. So a translation is an example of such a transformation. Given any point, a translation gives back a new point which is shifted by a set distance from the starting point in a given direction. Other examples you've seen include rotations and enlargements. The condition that isometries preserve distance means that if you start with two points of distance 10 apart, say, these get sent to two new points, and these new points must also be a distance 10 apart. This means that a translation is an isometry, because all points get shifted by the same amount, their relative distance remains the same. On the other hand, an enlargement is generally not an isometry, because it stretches or compresses the distance between points. That deals with what we mean by transformation in the definition of a symmetry. As for looking the same, an isometry will be a symmetry of a shape if, after the isometry has happened, you can't see any difference, even though the points of the shape may have been moved around. For example, here's the square from earlier. I've actually rotated it by 90 degrees, but there's no way that you can tell this just by looking at the square. To summarise, an isometry is a transformation of the plane which preserves the distance between points, and a symmetry of a shape is an isometry of the plane which leaves the shape looking the same after the isometry has happened. Let's put this into practice by looking at some specific examples. First of all, we said that a square is symmetric because we can rotate and reflect it. We should check that this fits with the definition of symmetry we just came up with. Certainly, rotations and reflections are transformations which leave the square unchanged, even as many of the points in the square are moved around within the square. Are they isometries, though? Do they preserve distance? I claim that these are both isometries. I'm going to leave it as an exercise for you to convince yourself of this, but just intuitively it makes sense. Imagine using a piece of paper to represent the plane. A rotation just means spinning the paper, and a reflection corresponds to turning the paper over. In both cases, we aren't stretching or twisting the paper, so the distance between points stays the same. Next, we thought about this shape, and it wasn't completely clear if it was symmetric or not. Is this symmetric using our definition? The only candidate for a symmetry would be a rotation by 180 degrees, but this sends black points to non-black points, so it doesn't end up looking the same, and so it isn't a symmetry. Therefore, this shape is not symmetric. If, however, you just look at the design of the shape without the shading, a rotation does leave the shape looking the same, so this shape is symmetric. I'll leave you to think about the question of whether or not my wallpaper is symmetric using our new definition. That more or less does it for the first video. I just want to make one more remark. If you followed along with Federico and Daniel's course on metric spaces, you might be wondering about metrics in general and not just the Euclidean metric. In fact, given any metric space, you can define an isometry in the same way, as a transformation of that space which preserves the distance between points in the space as measured by that metric. In this course, we won't work with general metric spaces, but instead focus on two or three very special metric spaces, the first of which being the Euclidean plane. If you visit the course webpage, which is linked in the description, you'll find I've left you several exercises to get you thinking a bit more about symmetries, both intuitively and using our definition, as well as working with isometries. I hope to see you in the next video.